And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We got two of our companions back. Calistes and Tiber last episode in the Oasis Fathom. Now let's see what awaits us in the Crefton Fathom.
Yes.
You can kind of see a little, like a little window. This place looks like a junkyard. Crefton. Give up, Toll. Slaver. Toll McGurr. All slavers. Watch her. She's stronger than she looks. Looks like it might be a much smaller area. Dim, sickly lights flicker underneath the surface of this massive carapace. Whatever is buried underneath here is never getting out. Someone has created a makeshift... I say we bleed her and be done. Someone has created a makeshift lean-to from pieces they found here. Halt, slaver. It just says give up toll. This is her illusion, though. This isn't real. Watch her. She's stronger than she looks. They all have their lines. A sharp, lemony scent pervades the air here. Every few minutes, a whiff of decaying flesh gusts forth before the lemon scent returns. Ooh. Someone's trying to hide the scent? Like a bunch of those air fresheners you hang from your car, rearview mirror? Lemony scent. And then all of a sudden you smell the corpse. And then, nope, the scent wins again. Oh, Eritus is over there. So it reminds me of what I'm talking about. That reminds me of that. And then what I'm talking about reminds me of the movie Seven with the guy. He's basically a living corpse covered with bed sores and, like, rotting alive and stuff. And he hangs all these things, all these car, these decorations, the little pine tree things. Like dozens of them above his bed to try to hide the scent. I always wonder how effective that would really be. Several small animals chitter somewhere beneath the detritus. Alright, let's talk to Toll McGurr. She's one of the outcasts that are stuck here. See, she's got the fever around her mind. A fog of confusion. A life of illusion. The slaver Toll McGurr is here, her arms flailing across her body. Shades of her tide-addicted compatriots flicker around her. Substanceless specters who radiate a burning, ephemeral need. Her hands pass through them, and each time she looks as if she was going to vomit. Her feet are buried in the ground. She cannot move. You feel the tides coil within you, perhaps as a response to the hungry ghosts that surround Toll. She thinks, I know these shades. I killed them, but accidentally. I'm not a killer. I'm not. I'm not gonna break her neck. If I use the tidal energy, it'll draw the sorrow, or it could draw the sorrow. These shades aren't real. You can free yourself. Running low on intelligence. She struggles and screams against the need of her erstwhile minions, but somehow your words penetrate the barrier of her fear. She opens her eyes and sees you. She reaches out a hand to you, and a spark of energy flashes between your fingertips. With it, awareness comes to her eyes. The shades fade away from around her, and she mouths silent gratitude. She rests her weary head on the floor of the labyrinth and sinks into the ground, leaving no trace behind. Okay. Oh, well, I guess we got her out of it. So much for a way of thanks. Now I can't climb up onto these things.
All right.
Oh, the Philethus! The Philethus thing! I remember that. Yeah, let's look at this stuff. Look, I can only look... Okay. These shifting, roiling infinities belie the reality of the mounds of junk. This is a place of memories, nothing more. This pile of debris rises and falls almost imperceptibly in regular intervals, as if something were breathing underneath it, though certainly nothing could live under there. This is a small place. We almost visit all of it. Let's talk to the, Kosh. I mean, Philethus. Hail, Kosh. You return to the beginning. As you approach the Philethus, you see its glass mask or face is covered in a spiderweb of fractures identical to those you inflicted on the Philethus outside the clock tower. A septic mist hisses from the cracks, sinking rather than rising as it dissipates. The Philethus says but a single word, maroon. Without further explication, it seems to turn in upon itself and in an instant is gone. Well, I'm not completely sure why we attacked it. I just wondered what would happen. So it's telling me maroon, like red tide? You never understand these things. This thing, he's more... I mean, I likened him to Kosh from Babylon 5 because of, like, the encounter suit and everything. And I'm thinking, you know, when he speaks, I think of Kosh's voice. I'm talking about Babylon 5, guys. Character in Babylon 5. Maroon. But, yeah. Very mysterious. And, yeah. Kosh makes more sense than this thing. I don't know what the friggin' thing's talking about. Ever. Including now. I can only guess. Goodbye. I don't know if we come across it again.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. We can interact here. Before we talk to Aratus, let's interact. Yeah, I guess this might be a smaller episode. So what is this thing? It looks like a snake with many eyes wrapped around a column. Oh, well, like a dragon maybe, because now I see the legs.
All right.
All right. Wrapped around an aging stone pillar is a plated creature unlike anything you've ever seen. It hisses at the air, but its eyes, rows of them, like a spider's, are fixed on you, glittering. It's just a statue, but your body trembles to look at it. It wants something, more than just flesh. There's a strong feeling of malevolent intelligence surrounding this statue that you can't explain. Even more worrying, however, is the sense of familiarity you get while looking at it. Move side to side to see if the spider-like eyes follow you. The eyes remain fixed at the space you were standing before. Perhaps you just happened to notice them when you were standing in the light. In the right, sorry. With slow and deliberate care, the eyes swivel in their stone sockets and fix on you again. Feel the surface of the statue? You reach out to touch the scaled surface. The statue doesn't move, and you hear nothing beyond the sound of your breath, and yet you feel something watching you from beyond this place. A sudden heat bakes the palm of your hand, something that tells you that touching this statue is a bad idea. All right, let's not touch it. Let your hand fall. The heat dies as you withdraw your hand, and the serpent's eyes gleam with laughter. Let's try to figure out why this feeling is so familiar with anamnesis. I need intelligence returned. Several memories strike you all at once, not memories of your own past life, but those of your siblings. You see yourself prostrate before a creature exactly like the statue, but larger and more menacing. You're in tears, terrified. The creature stretches out a claw, and some invisible force crushes your chest. Those are my siblings. A flash. Light from the creature's many eyes sears through your retina into your brain. You fall on the floor, unaware but unable to move. In another memory, you storm through a burning village in search of some artifact. The memory races forward, and you present that artifact to the creature. Another flash. You are kneeling before the creature. It speaks in your mind. Rise, my servant. Today you are no longer cast off. You are Dracogen. and you will henceforth speak in my name and carry out my will in this world. Dracogen's serving this thing? Is that what Dracogen's finding all these artifacts for? For this thing? The memories flee. You're left trembling. This thing is Dracogen. The real Dracogen, not the man. It uses mortals for its own inscrutable ends, even as mouthpieces, as it did with the Dracogen you had met in the bloom. Several castoffs had crossed it over the centuries. The creature finds the immortality and greed of your siblings useful, and their disregard for mortal lives convenient. This statue was constructed from their memories. One of them even served as a Dracogen long ago. I'm gonna touch it and see what happens. I'm gonna save first. Must be getting near to the end. 30... Oh, 130. 2. Oh, wait. Let's save. That's so slow. Oh, it is. Oh yeah, LP 131 and 132 are the last the Oasis Fathom. So we've got 133. Forgot that's not just one episode. Alright, so if we touch it,
I'm ready.
She's ready. You reach out for the statue again. A blistering heat builds in the air around your hand, as if waiting to see if you'll be foolish enough to lay your hand on the statue this time. Touch it. Took 7 damage. Your fingertip scrapes across one of the gleaming scales. You hear a low, angry hiss before clawed hands close over your head from behind and squeeze. The darkness closes and coils around you, crushing the air from your lungs. Shouted words from the beast strike your mind like misshapen, burning meteors. You try to scream, but nothing escapes. Nothing. Could be worth it, then. We got an item. Only 7 hit points. You awaken by inches, every joint aching. Something lies heavy and cold in your hand. At first you take the gem lying there for one of the statue's eyes, and then you notice that the serpent is still as whole and untouched as before. So we gained a recalcitrant stone, which is an ornament, gives you 5 armor and 5 resistance. Sweet. Attached to a fine chain is a hunk of polished meteoric metal fashioned into the shape of an eye. While cool to the touch, it has the bright glow of cooling metal that does not seem to dissipate. You can sense a barely contained surging power behind the glow, a promise of power to those who can control it. You gain this item at great cost by plucking it from a malevolent scaled statue. Uh-huh. Wasn't that great a cost? Okay. So we're getting a lot of sphere-type looking things lately. So the ornament, this gives me 5 armor, 5 resistance. What does he have? That deals 5 chemical damage to enemies entering or starting their turn in immediate range. Also has 4 resistance. And what does he have? Confer energize. Choose a damage type. You know, I'm going to take this off and give him this. We'll give her this. Yeah. This will help her. She's always getting hurt, so. Some resistance and AC will definitely help. Haha. Energized. Did I really use up all her ciphers except for one? This would be good for Tiber, wouldn't it? Plus one might edge and plus five armor. Oh wait.
That's the stuff.
Ah, I used it. Nope. I'll be right back, guys. I gotta load my save again. Okay, yeah, I can't believe I actually took that. Activated it. I was just trying to drag it to... Well, I dragged the other one to Tiber. Here's this one now, with the might. That suits his abilities. He's a fighter. And this can go for Calisthenes. Cool. Alright. And that's the whole zone. It's a lot smaller than the Oasis. So let's talk to Aretas. And I'm guessing that's going to be closing out the episode. I love that theme. Aretas stands, fists clenched and knuckles white, at the center of his aura, his golden cloud. It takes you a moment to realize what's different here. He is in a hollow place within the glow, though it is reaching for him with hooked tendrils and jagged spines. Somehow, Aretas is holding the paragons and cathartics at bay. Tell me how I can help you. I don't know, he whispers. I just know that I can't hold. I can't... Let us in, roar the paragons. We had a bargain, Aretas. You can't go back on it just because you didn't agree to it in the first place. If he didn't agree to it in the first place, then yeah, he can. Let us in, whined the cathartics. We're in danger out here. We are exposed. It is very cold. Ugh, what do I do? Leave him alone. Your voice echoes and the audience recoils at the sound. Aretas' space within the aura grows. Let us into him again, the audience pleads. Let us make him strong, weak. Without us, he will be useless to you. He will be normal, fragile, weak, pathetic. I need his help. Aretas, I need you to be a hero, not a herder. Aretas flinches, as if your words hurt him, and perhaps they did, for he sags, surrendering, lowering his head, and the aura closes on him like spilling water, drowning him under it. He thinks, that was everything I had. That was it. Aww. Why? We help Tiber, and he comes with us. We help Aretas and Calisthenes, and they're gone? They can't help us? Maybe I can get back to this like the one with Calisthenes. I'm hoping that after this is all said and done, I can help him?
I'll remember that.
Twitching lightly, the hero straightens. His hair is shining once more, and his skin is young again. He gives you a wide, welcoming grin. Where have you been? Never mind. Don't answer that. I'm terrible at listening to answers. I'm sorry, Aretas. What? He says, eyebrows nearly flying off his forehead. I don't need apologies. I don't even know what you're apologizing for. He grins, almost, but not entirely. His grin, almost, but not entirely, hides the waning desperation in his eyes. It's time for us to confront the Spectre. Are you with me? Artaglio's cunning. Of course.
I don't know if I like it in here. It makes me feel like a trespasser, and not in an exciting, daring way.
I'm talking inside your head.
That was so funny. How are you holding up? I can't complain. Well, I guess I could, but I'm not in the mood. There's some questions about you. I don't think this is the best time to talk about me. I mean, we're in you. Alright, let's go. I hope I get to help him after everything. Now, the others aren't with us. We can undoubtedly just help them.
All right.
If I'm running across them, I'm not even sure. I don't know who waits in the village, Fathom. Rin was in a village. Now, I'm just gonna... Oh, he can level up. Stat pools. Might. How about 2 might? Now I'm going to quickly save again. And since we have some time left, I mean, this will be a short episode. I want to see what happens if I go into the Sorrow's Fathom, or the... Well, not this one, but the Clock Fathom or Daughter's Fathom. Is there anything new in there? There might not be. This is where I fought the Sorrow last time in our mind and basically drove it out of our mind. All those fragments. So colorful. Is there anyone or anything here? Doesn't look like there is. Okay.
On it.
I'm gonna check out the Clock Fathom then. And that other one. This is Daughter's Fathom.
Of course.
Of course it is. Who's that? I was looking. Sijin? We talked to Sijin before, right? Is this the same that we've seen before? Do you know what these are? Huh. Gravestones and cenotaphs surround you. The ghostly woman looks out across the graveyard. Do you know what these are? Those who died in the siege? They're the fruit of that damn engine. I remember now. It copied me over and over and over, overriding the lives of other girls with my life, as if I mattered more than they did. She wipes the back of her hand across her face. He thought it was never perfect enough, but it was all too perfect. I died before I was 20, so the engine made sure that all of them died at the same age. She looks at you, ghostly tears glistening in her eyes. It's still doing it, right now, in the real world. You have to stop it. Tell him. Oh. Tell my father what his obsession is doing. He has to stop it.
Updated my journal.
This is a bug. We didn't update anything. I found Aratus being attacked by his glow. Yeah, I guess we shouldn't even be here. We screwed with that, with stuff. There's our friends they didn't come with. Yeah, this is just repeating everything we've done before. He isn't here. Yeah. She shouldn't be... Her father's not here now. She shouldn't be adding quests even though she didn't... She shouldn't be saying these words. So... Let's run real quick into the Clock Fathom. And see what that holds. I wonder if I can rest once before... going into that last fathom, because I have 2 intelligence. I mean, I do. I have 4 of these. 6 points of intellect. I can take 2 or 3 of them. Let's check in the clock fathom. Just want to see if anyone or anything is in there. Yeah, this is empty. It's nothing. Okay.
Let's go.
This is where we fought the sorrow fragments with those three other cast-offs. The first ones we actually met. Kasmin and Mimion. Oh wait, Kasmin and Mimion were the Cult of the Changing God. Yeah, I don't remember their names. There's 2 men and a woman. He's really injured. Holy crap.
I'm ready.
So I have 1 more fathom to go through.
Ready.
I can sleep here with Lady Ansh. He's just walking slowly and the rest of us are running. Oh, and Dilla will hop and skip over to us. Ghostly woman. Yeah, so next episode, I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna save here, just in case it's a bad idea. And then we're gonna go to the middle one, the village fathom. If all is not lost from sleeping once. I mean, why would they give us this option to sleep, right, if we couldn't? I would think we can do it once. So, I want to get my intelligence back and some of this stuff. And his, Aretas' hit points. So thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And enduring. Grow strong.